Hey there, Psych 370 students, and welcome to your first video lecture for week 15. This week, we're starting in on the final chapter of the textbook that we'll be covering this semester, chapter 10, which focuses on observational learning. So we'll tackle the first 20 pages or so this week, and then next week, we'll finish off that chapter. Now, guys, we've devoted the last 7 weeks of this course to operant conditioning, which is to say that we've spent those weeks thinking about the learning that occurs when animals perform behaviors themselves and then experience firsthand the reinforcing or punishing consequences that follow those behaviors. But obviously, that's not the only way to strengthen or weaken a behavior, right? It's not the only way to learn something. We're also capable of this more third-party kind of learning, where we simply observe an event and its consequences and then change our own behavior as a result of what we've witnessed. And so that's what we're talking about here with observational learning. So for example, a few years ago, I bought a new car, new to me anyway, and I didn't know how to change the oil in it. So I watched a video on YouTube where somebody showed me how to do it. That's how I learned to perform that task. I just observed it being done, and then I copied what I saw. Or here's another example. When I first started high school, I thought, hey, I'm in high school now. It's okay to chew gum in class. That's what I thought at first. But then I saw someone else get in trouble for chewing gum in class. And so, of course, I learned not to chew gum in class myself, at least not when the teacher was watching. So sometimes after we observe an event and its consequences, we become more likely to perform a particular behavior. That behavior gets strengthened. We acquire that behavior. So in those cases, we say that we have been vicariously reinforced. But other times, after we observe an event and its consequences, we become less likely to perform a particular behavior. That behavior gets weakened. We learn to suppress that behavior. And so in those cases, we say that we've been vicariously punished. And the word vicarious, by the way, basically means experienced through another person. Okay? It comes from the Latin word for substitute. In fact, the same Latin root appears in the word vice, as in vice president. And so often when we learn by observation, we do it by watching someone else's behavior and its consequences, and then using that observation as a sort of substitute for our own firsthand experience. So anyway, observational learning is an important and fairly common form of learning, but it's kind of interesting that researchers haven't always treated it that way. So as your book points out, interest in observational learning has really waxed and waned over the last 100+ years. There have been long stretches of time where researchers basically ignored observational learning as a topic of study. And guys, one reason for that is that many researchers didn't believe they could study observational learning in non-human animals like they could classical or operant conditioning. So for example, Thorndike conducted some of the earliest research on observational learning, and he concluded that it was unique to humans. So he found that even if one cat watched another cat solve a particular puzzle box, that observer cat didn't appear to learn the solution. So when Thorndike put the observer into the puzzle box and gave it a crack at escaping itself, he found that that cat behaved just like a naive cat who had never observed the model. So Thorndike doubted that observational learning was possible in non-human animals. And John Watson came to the same conclusion after he failed to find evidence of observational learning in monkeys. So guys, those are two pretty big names in the history of learning research, right? Edward Thorndike, John Watson, and they're both taking the position that observational learning simply does not occur in non-human animals. But of course, today we know that Thorndike and Watson were wrong about that, because many studies since their time have provided strong evidence that animals can, in fact, learn through observation. Now, your textbook provides several examples of this, but a classic one was reported by a couple of researchers named Marvin Herbert and Charles Harsh, who had cats try to solve a so-called turntable problem. They called it the turntable problem. So a cat would be in a cage like this. It would be presented with this circular rotating platform that had food on the side opposite the cat. And so to get the food, the cat just had to turn that table. It had to rotate that circular platform. And as you can see in this picture, what Herbert and Harsh did was they presented the turntable problem to one cat. And as it learned to solve the problem, other cats would watch the learning trials that this model cat was going through. And then after watching either 15 or 30 of the model's trials with the turntable problem, the observer cats got to try it for themselves. And Herbert and Harsh obtained the results that you're seeing in this graph. So what we're looking at here are average solution times on the first trial for the turntable problem, as well as several other problems that the cats were presented with. And as you can see here, the observers tended to outperform the models. So whereas it took the models an average of over 100 seconds to figure out the solution to a problem the first time around, the observers were able to solve the problems much more quickly than that, especially if they had observed all 30 of the models' learning trials, as opposed to just the last 15. And so the take-home message here is that those observers clearly benefited from the chance to watch the model. They clearly learned from those observations. More recently, these guys Akins and Zental have reported evidence of observational learning in the quail, which is a type of bird. So basically what they found was that quail are much more likely to operate a lever for food in whatever way they saw being successful for a model quail. So some observers saw models who had been trained to peck the lever. Others saw models who had been trained to step on it. And the observers could operate the lever either way. But as you can see in the graph, they tended to do whatever they had observed the model doing. Similar results have been found with other species too, like rats, chickens, chimpanzees. And there's also an interesting report of observational learning apparently occurring in the wild. That example involves a troop of monkeys who were living on a beach in Japan, and the researcher would spread these grains of wheat for the monkeys along the beach. And at first, the monkeys would go through this painstaking process of picking up the wheat grains one by one and eating them that way. But eventually, one of the monkeys figured out that she could just grab a handful of the wheat and sand mixture, throw it into the water, and then skim the wheat off of the surface of the water because it would float, whereas the sand would sink. So once that monkey learned to separate the wheat from the sand that way, other monkeys in the troop started doing it too. That behavior spread throughout the whole troop once other monkeys saw it and started imitating it. Not only that, but they also appeared to learn other behaviors through observation, like washing the sand off of sweet potatoes and bathing themselves in the ocean. According to the researcher, the monkeys had never performed these behaviors before, but those behaviors also spread through the troop after one monkey tried them and other monkeys imitated them. So not only can animals learn through observation, it looks like they do it naturally too, not just in these contrived situations that researchers present them with in laboratories. And guys, here's one more sort of natural example of observational learning that I think you might find interesting. It was reported by Karen Pryor, the animal trainer whom I've mentioned a few times already during this course, and it involved two dolphins that Pryor had trained alongside each other to do different routines with different tricks for performances. So each dolphin had its own stunts that it learned to do, and when it wasn't performing, it would be kept in this separate area where it could look on and observe the other one. Well, one day, during an actual performance, Pryor noticed that her dolphins seemed nervous, as she put it. They were acting kind of funny, and their performances were unusually awkward. Still, each one managed to perform the tricks that she prompted it to do. They weren't perfect, but they still performed well enough to complete the show. It wasn't until after the show, as the audience was leaving, that Pryor's assistant told her what had happened. Before the show, the two dolphins had accidentally been put into the wrong holding tanks. So when they brought one dolphin out, they thought it was the other one, and vice versa. And so each dolphin had actually performed the other one's routine. So apparently, as a result of working in such close proximity with each other and observing each other for so long, these dolphins had each picked up on the other one's tricks, even though they were never explicitly trained to perform those tricks. Now, these weren't easy tricks. They each took several weeks to train, but each dolphin was able to learn those tricks, at least to some extent, just by observing them. So again, guys, the point is that contrary to what Thorndike and Watson thought, observational learning does seem to be something that many animal species are capable of, not just humans. Okay, well, that's about all I have to say as far as introductory comments on observational learning. In my next video lecture, I'll be contrasting observational learning with a few other types of social influence. So please be sure to check that out when you get a chance. And please also let me know if you have questions about anything. That's all I've got for you for now, though. So take care.